Welcome to week 4 of the Healing Hotspots series. We hope that your group is coming together and you're all forming relationships with one another. It's amazing to consider that a close relationship with God is actually possible. The Healing Hotspot is a common ground where we're able to know and be known by God. But how do we get there? How do we enter into and maintain a close relationship with God? Today, Pastor Darren is going to reveal the heart attitude that allows us to connect with God and stay in relationship with Him. The questions in your group guide will help focus your group's discussion. Be sure and check out the interview with Pastor Darren at the end of your time together.
And that brings us to week 3. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves. Underline that in your Bible and or on your outline. Those 3 words, will humble themselves. Those are the 3 words we're going to focus on for the next 20 minutes. Now, notice something right off the top. God is describing and prescribing something that we, you and I, must do as Christ followers, and even as someone who's seeking God. We must humble ourselves. Every now and then I hear someone say, pray, oh God, humble me. I'm thinking, no, you don't want to pray that prayer. The Bible says we should humble ourselves. So then, how can a follower of Jesus remain in or return to God's healing hotspot? Well, you recognize your role, you recognize your reality, and as we're learning today, you choose humility. Choose humility. Well, what does it mean to choose humility? What is humility? I mean, what does it mean to be humble? First of all, let's talk about what it is not, what it isn't. As your outline says, humility isn't making less of who you are. Humility is not making less of who you are. I hear this and see this every now and then. Someone, let's say they sing a song in church or whatever, and you walk up to them in the lobby afterwards and you say, hey, great job with that solo today. And this person says, oh, no, I'm a terrible singer. I can't sing. I'm a worm. I'm a lousy singer. And if you thought it was good, that's just because God somehow supernaturally made it sound better. That's not humility. Humility isn't making less of who you are. Okay, then what is humility? Well, to answer that question, let's turn to a passage in the New Testament portion of the Bible. Near the end of the New Testament, it's the book of James. And in this passage, humility is explained by contrasting it with its opposite, with pride. It's found in James chapter 4. As you're turning there, let me quickly tell you who James was. James was Jesus' brother. And initially, James thought that his brother Jesus was crazy. In fact, while Jesus walked the earth, James did not follow Jesus. He literally thought he was crazy. It's in the Gospels. But after seeing his brother Jesus risen from the dead, James saw reality, and he became a follower of Jesus, and he became a leader in the early church. And in fact, James wrote this letter that we have in our hands, and it's a letter to Christ followers who are scattered throughout the world, and they're being persecuted. And James says this in James chapter 4, verse 6. He says, God opposes the proud, but he shows favor to the humble. Now, let's put these two extremes on a continuum here. Proud on one end and humble on the other. By the way, James' original letter here was written in ancient Greek. That was the universal language of the first century, like English would be today. And as your outline says, the ancient Greek word that's translated proud in this verse literally means to overshine. Not to shine, but to overshine, to mega shine. To be proud is to overshine. It's not wrong to shine. Shining is good. Shine on. But when you overshine, that's when you've crossed the line into the pride zone. Well, what does it look like to overshine? Someone says, hey, Darren, I like your shoes. I say, oh, thanks. They are nice, aren't they? My wife bought them for me. Okay, at this point, I'm not overshining. I'm fine. I'm shining. Everything's fine. Now watch as I begin to overshine. Yeah, these shoes are nice, aren't they? In fact, these shoes are the best. There's nobody in all of Broadway Church today who has shoes like my shoes. These are the greatest shoes of anybody. I looked around at everybody as they came in today. I was hiding back up there behind the screen looking at everyone's shoes. These are the best shoes at Broadway Church. In fact, why have you stopped looking at my shoes? Keep looking at my shoes. Yes, these are fantastic shoes. And if you think your shoes are as good as mine, you're crazy. You're thinking your shoes aren't as good as mine, aren't you? Well, you're right. Your shoes are garbage compared to my shoes. That is overshining. Being proud is overstating your case. It's taking things beyond what they truly are. By the way, after the first service, someone tweeted me and said, Darren, I really do like your shoes, by the way. Have you ever met a proud person? Have you ever met someone that tends to overshine at times? Chances are you didn't like interacting with them, did you? A CEO of a Fortune 500 company pulled into a full-service gas station to get some gas. Well, then he went inside to pay, and when he came out, he noticed his wife engaged in a conversation with the guy who was pumping gas into their car. It turns out this wife knew the gas attendant. In fact, it turns out she dated this guy in high school before she met her husband. Well, the CEO got into the car, and the two of them drove away in silence for a moment. Feeling pretty good about himself, the CEO finally speaks up. He says, I bet I know what you're thinking, honey. Yeah, I bet you're thinking you're pretty glad you married me. A Fortune 500 CEO, and not him, a gas station attendant. Wife says, actually, I wasn't thinking that at all. She says, I was thinking that if I'd married him, he'd probably be a Fortune 500 CEO and you'd be a gas station attendant. What is it about prideful people that we find so distasteful? I mean, even God finds pride distasteful. James says that God opposes the proud in this verse. Literally, in ancient Greek, James said, God actually goes to battle against the proud, is what he literally says. The writer of Proverbs in the Old Testament goes even further. In Proverbs 6, it says, there are six things the Lord hates, seven that are detestable to him. Haughty eyes. Now, he goes on to list even more. And if you want to read the entire ugly list, you can do that on your own time. But for now, just notice what made the top of God's hate list. Haughty eyes. It literally means a proud look. It's describing a person who views the world through eyes of arrogance. God hates such an attitude. Why? Why does God hate pride so much? Maybe God hates pride so much because it appears to have been the original sin. When you look at Scripture, it appears that Satan's, Lucifer's, first sin was pride. He overshone. He looked at himself and said, I'm beautiful. That's not overshining, it was truth. He was a beautiful angel. But then he thought to himself, I am so beautiful, I'm more beautiful than all the others. In fact, I can arise and I'm going to be like God. Oops, he crossed the line. And then it just overflowed into creation, that arrogance and that pride. Perhaps God hates pride so much because pride destroys everything it touches. The Bible says in Proverbs, pride comes before destruction, and a haughty spirit comes before a fall. Pride always leaves a trail of brokenness behind it. Maybe God hates pride so much because pride is rooted in and continually fueled by lies. Now remember, pride is overshining. It's taking things beyond what they truly are. So to begin to even get into pride, you've got to lie to yourself and lie to the people around you. That's just getting into a prideful attitude. But to maintain a prideful attitude, you have to keep topping up the lies. You have to keep lying to yourself every single time, every single moment. You have to live fueled by deceit. Is it any wonder that God opposes such an attitude in life? Okay, well, that's what pride looks like, but what does humility look like? Well, as your outline says, the word James used for humble means not rising far from the ground. Not rising far from the ground. Now, is James saying that the shorter you are, the more humble you are? Now, rest easy, all of you tall people out there. James is not saying that. So what is he saying then? You're interested in hiring Mary for a position on your staff. And so you start to ask around. You say, tell me about Mary. What kind of a person is Mary? And someone says, Mary is a woman with both feet firmly on the ground. Now, when we say that in English, we are complimenting them. We're saying Mary is stable. Mary is dependable. Mary is a woman of sound and solid character. That's what we're saying by that phrase. Well, that's similar to the ancient word for the meaning of humble. To be humble is to not rise far from the ground. It means to live life with both feet firmly planted. It means to have an honest perspective on life, to have a firm grasp of reality. So when you place pride and humility side by side, you can see the contrast. Being proud is overstating your case. It's taking things beyond what they truly are. But as your outline says, humility is properly acknowledging who you are. It's properly acknowledging who you are. It's looking at reality and living according to reality. Look what Paul said in Romans 12, verse 3. He said, listen, don't think of yourself more highly than you ought. Don't let your feet get too far off the ground when you look at yourself. Don't think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather, here's what you ought to do. Think of yourself with sober judgment. In other words, tell the truth about yourself. If you're good at golf, then say, yeah, I'm a pretty good golfer. If you're a good singer and someone says you sang well, say, thank you, I appreciate that. But don't think of yourself more highly, but look at yourself with sober judgment, meaning what is reality in accordance with the faith that God has distributed to each of us, Scripture says. So when you think about it, there's nothing more relaxing, there's nothing more natural than living a life of humility. Why? Because humility, it's just properly acknowledging who you are. It takes no effort. Humility is simply facing and telling the truth about yourself. My mother always used to say, and I hear Judge Judy say it, so Judge Judy must have met my mother sometime. But my mother always used to say, Darren, when you tell the truth, you don't have to have a good memory. And it's true. When you tell the truth, you don't have to sit and think, okay, what did I say I did last night? Oh, yeah. Because when you're always lying, you got to remember what lie you told, and then you got to tell another lie to back up that lie. And then you pile lie upon lie. It's exhausting. So I've been told. But when you tell the truth, you don't have to have a good memory because you just know what happened. And according to James, that is the attitude that God endorses. James said that God is in opposition to the proud, but God shows favor to the humble. God literally said through James that God gives grace to the humble. That's literally what that word show favor means. It means to give grace. Do you hear what James is saying, folks? God shows favor to the humble. God gives grace to the humble. James is saying, to pull it back to Chronicles in our hotspot, he's saying, when you humble yourself, when you choose humility, you are positioning yourself to receive the restorative power of God. He gives grace to the humble. James is saying, when you live with an attitude of humility, you are living in God's healing hotspot, where the power of God flows, where the grace of God is poured out. So where are you on this continuum? Which zone do you tend to live in more often than not? Are you living a life of pride or a life of humility? Are you overshining, always polishing your life? Are you pretending to be someone you're not? By the way, it takes a whole lot of extra energy to overshine. And the irony is, get this, I thought about this week. When you are overshining, when you overshine, you're actually living in the darkness. It's counterintuitive, but it's true. That's not what you want. That's not what God wants. God wants to pour grace and healing into your life. And there's only one place where this downloading of grace can occur, and that's God's healing hotspot, this relationship zone. We say, Darren, if I've stepped away from that healing hotspot, is there a way to get back in? There is. 2 Chronicles 7:14 says you can. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, if you want back into God's light, you need to abandon your proud posture and choose a posture of humility. Okay, practically speaking, how can a person do that? Practically speaking, how can a person move from pride to humility? Well, let's go back to James chapter 4, because James gives us some simple and practical advice in James 4. Starting at James chapter 4, verse 13, we read this. Now listen, you who say, today or tomorrow we're going to go to this or that city, we're going to spend a year there, carry on business, and make money. James says, oh, hold on, time out, hit the pause button. James says, why, you don't even know what will happen tomorrow. What's your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, here's what you ought to say, James says. If it's the Lord's will, then we'll live and we'll do this and do that. According to James, if you want to humble yourself, you need to, first of all, acknowledge your limitations. Acknowledge your limitations. Now listen, folks. James isn't saying it's wrong to plan. That's not what he's teaching here. I have calendars filled with events. My life is planned week by week, day by day, month by month, to the end of 2019 right now. I could tell you what sermon I'm preaching on this Sunday next year. He's not saying it's wrong to plan. It's not wrong to make plans. But James is simply pointing out that our plans are thinner than the paper they're printed on. That's all he's saying. I can plan months and years ahead. But the truth is, I really have no idea what will happen tomorrow. And actually, James is being modest here. He's understating the truth. The truth is, I don't even know what's going to happen today. Hey, the next 10 seconds are a mystery to me. I have notes on the page in front of me, but it is entirely possible that I may not get a chance to speak these words. It's totally within the realm of possibility. In fact, that possibility became very real to me this week. One of my best friends died suddenly. I got the call this week from his daughter, Darren, Ken, my dad, her dad, died 3 hours ago, sudden heart attack. You remember Ken? He spoke here at Broadway last year. Ken's big idea was, for this we have Jesus. Remember, he was my guest, my friend from England who spoke. Ken died suddenly this week. One of my best friends. Known him for decades. Went to bed, died. After preaching on Sunday. We are incredibly uninformed when it comes to the future. We have no idea what will happen next. When Ken laid his head on his pillow, he didn't know he would never raise his head from that pillow. He's in his 50s. Why, you don't even know what will happen tomorrow, James points out. And not only are we incredibly ignorant, we're also incredibly fragile. The truth is, like Pistol Pete Maravich or like my good friend Ken, we could be saying, I feel great 1 minute, and drop dead the next minute. What's your life, James asks. You're a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Like our hazer machines that spread the haze in the services. It's gone now. It was here a minute ago. James says, that's your life. You're a mist. So when you pull it all together, this is the truth about my life. Here it is. I am entirely ignorant about the next second of my existence, and I am incredibly fragile regarding the stability of my existence. So stand back, world, and watch me roar. Kind of sounds silly, doesn't it, when you put it that way? It's hard to be proud when your feet are firmly planted on the ground. It's hard to overshine when you acknowledge your limitations. So what can a person do to move from pride to humility? Well, first, acknowledge your limitations. And secondly, acknowledge God's lordship. Instead, James says, here's what you ought to say when you make your plans. If it's the Lord's will, we'll live and do this or do that. Now, he's not saying that every time you make a plan, you have to publicly say, if it's the Lord's will. Having said that, I'll often do that. In an email or in a conversation, when someone says, can you be here, do this? I'll often say, yep, Lord willing, I'll be there. Now, by saying that, I am not trying to provide a way to sneak out. But what I am consciously saying to myself, because I'm very aware of this truth, I'm consciously trying to remind myself how fragile I am and how not in control of my life I ultimately am. I'm trying to acknowledge consciously God's lordship in my life. His knowledge, his power, his sovereignty. I will make my plans and I will do my best to fulfill those plans, but I ultimately acknowledge it's all Lord willing. He can change the direction of my life in a heartbeat. It's been said that, one author put it this way, in God, we come up against something which in every aspect is immeasurably superior to us. But he said, as long as we're proud, we cannot know God. Why? Because a proud person is someone who is always looking down on others. So you can't see something that's above you when you're constantly looking down. Folks, to enter God's kingdom, you have to bow to God's superiority. But pride refuses to bow. So let's wrap it up. What have we learned today? If we want to access God's restorative and healing power, we need to choose humility. We need to humble ourselves. What does that look like? It looks like properly acknowledging who you truly are. Humility is living grounded in reality. Humility is living according to the truth. And we learn that God shows favor to those who live this way. We learn that God pours grace and blessing and power upon the humble. If you want to live in God's healing hotspot, you must choose humility. How does one choose and then live in humility? It's simple. You do this by acknowledging your limitations and acknowledging God's lordship. Which brings us to today's big idea. Here's the summary of everything we've learned today in this one simple sentence. To be where God is, you must be who you are. If you want to be where God is, you've got to be who you are. Because the moment you stop being who you are living a fantasy. You're living deception. You're deceiving yourself and others. If you want to be where God is, you got to humble yourself. You got to live according to reality. You got to be who you are.
Hello and welcome to week 4 of the Healing Hotspot series. In this session, Pastor Darren talked about the importance of humility to staying in the healing hotspot. And Darren, in this message, you talk about the need for self-awareness. Now, the reality is we all have blind spots. So what is the source of those self-deceiving messages that get in the way of honest self-understanding? Like, why do we tend to fool ourselves the way we do?
Well, I think you can almost go back to the beginning with Adam and Eve in Genesis. They were in the healing hotspot, in a sense. They were in Eden, they were in relationship with God, but then they invited sin into their lives. And now I think there's a lot of metaphorical language in Genesis, but what's happening there is, what happens is, when they're aware of their sin, what do? They immediately see their nakedness, and suddenly they feel shame. And so what do? They go get animal skins and they cover themselves. Mm-hmm. And then they hide from God. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a pattern there that sin reproduces each time. There's awareness, which produces shame, which leads to concealment. And that's what we do. We become aware deep in our own hearts. We know that we are not who we should be. Deep in our hearts, we're aware of our own sinfulness. And so what do? We feel embarrassment. We feel shame about this. And so how do we respond? Well, there's two ways you can respond. The right way is to repent, confess, and go to God and ask for restoration. But what we tend to do often is, instead, we conceal and we cover up and justify and pretend and or deny. And that's like putting skins over top of our nakedness.
Yeah.
I don't want to kind of get down on all the people who are, you know, really happy and involved with social media, but social media kind of allows us to put up that smoke screen.
Oh, absolutely.
To hide behind. Yeah. And try to present ourselves as having a more exciting, a better life than maybe we really are.
Yeah. It's like taking a picture on my iPhone, and then what do? Before I post it, whatever, I put it through a filter. And I, you know, take out what I didn't want there, and I choose, do I want a bright light? I want to make those colors more vivid. That's not reality, but it's nicer than actual reality.
Yeah. So self-awareness is really seeing yourself in the mirror as you really are. Could I say seeing yourself as God sees you?
Yes, it's telling yourself the truth.
Yeah, okay. Let me ask you this question. You know, you have identified humility as one of the key pieces in being in the healing hotspot. Why is pretense so pointless when it comes to relating with God?
Pretense is pointless because God has X-ray vision, if you can think in those terms. So what do you, you're not fooling anyone. It's like the foolish man at the airport. He's lining up to go through the X-ray machine, and he's got knives and guns, you know, under his coat. What are you thinking? You're going to go through the X-ray machine. They're going to see all of those things. You're not fooling anyone. It's absolute irrationality. And so pretense, pretending you're someone you're not in the presence of God, is, again, we come back to, like we spoke of a couple of weeks ago, it's the irrationality of sin.
Why is it that humility is so important to God? It comes up all over in the scriptures. God, you said it in this message,
yeah.
God blesses the humble, but he resists the proud.
Because humility is ground zero for relationship with God. Anything other than humility, and you're pretending you're someone you're not. Anything other than humility. Humility is not thinking less of yourself. Humility is seeing yourself as you truly are. It's not puffing yourself up, it's being you. And I believe we said in this week, you know, that you are, to be where God is, you have to be who you are. Because God, it's the Spirit, he's the Spirit of truth. And when you tell yourself the truth, you meet the Spirit of truth. It's truth. Humility is truth.
Okay. So thank you, Pastor Darren, for helping us kind of think through this issue of humility. Next week when we get together, Pastor Paul Moores is going to be talking about the prayer portion of remaining in the healing hotspot. Really important message. You don't want to miss it. And we look forward to seeing you next week.